please welcome David Kantor.
Thank you for that very generous introduction, Phil. You were really kind, not to mention the several disasters that have occurred along the way. It's been an interesting journey, and it's not over yet, and it's really wonderful to be here with you all. I hope we have a good time. I'm planning on it. I hope you do, too. Taking a look at this question that has been posed. Let me set this up here and make sure that it's running, and we'll begin. And I want to provide some context and background. I'm hopeful that the discussion period at the end will be the real heart of what we're doing. And you people in that upper balcony, if you can't see the screens, you can log in online and look on your tablets. So let's take off. 60 years have passed since the publication of the Urantia Book. And the world continues to be transformed by a communications revolution that's more significant than Gutenberg's press. And it's an environment that we're in with an epical revelation. Counting internet downloads, we're getting close to 1 million copies of the Urantia Book out there in the world. It's been a lot of work. A lot of people have dedicated themselves to getting that out there. But we're starting to enter a new phase now that requires us to completely rethink how we're approaching this revelation dissemination task. This is the question that I was asked to address. What should Urantia organizations be doing to promote the revelation? And I want to remind us that organizations are collections of individuals. You know, they don't have wills and purposes of their own. They're comprised of individuals, you and me. In asking this question about what the organization should be doing, it seems reasonable to ask another question. Well, what's already being done? You know, maybe we should just take a look, get a little inventory of what's actually being done out there. And that leads us to another question. What does the book say we ought to be doing? You know, what are the revelators hoping happens here? So these three questions kind of form the backbone of what I'd like to hit this afternoon. However, before we can consider those, there's one other that should be considered, and that is, what's the context in which we're trying to promote the revelation? And I'm going to spend a lot of time on context. These other things, what's being done and what does the book say needs to be do, are essentially just lists of things that we can look at. But I'd like to talk a little bit about the context, and I'm going to reverse the order of these. If we look at 4, 3, and 2, that'll give us some good background and a good basis for then talking about this a little bit. I'll make a few suggestions here, but I'm really hoping that the discussion period will open that up. There have been two major developments in the Urantia community's first half century which are having far-reaching consequences. In terms of bringing the revelation to the world, these two items are second only to the publication of the book. Now, the first one is the publication and dissemination of translations. I think that what Urantia Foundation has done with getting these translations out is absolutely phenomenal. And my hat's off to the foundation, the trustees, the people who contributed to make this possible. There's now, I believe it's 16 translations that are in distribution, and another 4 are in production, and there are a number of revisions to the original translations, all happening out there. This is huge. It's huge. The second major development was the passing of the copyright into the public domain concomitant with the rise of the internet. This precipitated a mobilization of readers eager to join in the dissemination effort. These two things, getting those translations out there and having readers be able to get on the internet and do whatever they're going to do, has made a huge difference in getting that book out into the world. So let's start with item number 4 on our list. What's the context in which the revelation is to be promoted? You know, if you're preparing a flight plan, it might be good to know something about the weather in the area where you're going to be flying, right? The classic Urantia Book illustration of the importance of context is that saber-toothed tiger story. You all know that story. By the way, I have to say, I'm assuming a Urantia Book literate audience here. And because of the nature of the question, I'm also assuming that you know a little bit about the organizations, their history, and the issues that are confronting the organizations. There's three little areas here that I want to look into: the cosmological context, the cultural, and the historical context. Dispensations. The Urantia Book talks about planetary dispensations. You know, think of a dispensation like a large universe frame, a meta frame, if you will. It's a context within which the celestial administrators work for a period of time. At the beginning of each dispensation, a divine son comes, sets up the potentials that are to be actualized in that dispensation. And then during the course of the dispensation, all of the planetary government, all of the celestial background are working to get that actualized. Once that's actualized, then in the next dispensation, we'll use that as a foundation. The present dispensation is the dispensation of the Spirit of Truth. Urantia Book also refers to it as the Christian dispensation. Think of the Spirit of Truth as a directionizing force back behind cultural evolution. It's just this force that's moving evolution in a particular direction. This bestowed comforter is the spiritual force which ever draws all truth seekers toward him who is the personification of truth in the local universe. That's powerful. You know, the Spirit of Truth is the primary force with which we're dealing with as we try to get the revelation into the world. Without the planetary prince, without the Adamic regime, getting this planet into light and life is going to be pretty much an inside job. And the Spirit of Truth is what's leading that way. This is Michael's personal spirit. It's his personal spirit. It's as if he were physically here. This is what he would be doing. This would be how he would be trying to move evolution forward. I'm going to give you four quotes about the Spirit of Truth, just to set the background. And I promise I'm not going to sling quotes at you all afternoon. But I do want to step through these four quotes because I think they're important for setting the context. The Spirit of Truth is almost wholly limited in function and power by man's personal reception of that which constitutes the sum and substance of the mission of the bestowal son. The Spirit of Truth is designed to live in man and for each new generation to restate the Jesus message so that every new group of mortals to appear upon the face of the earth shall have a new and up-to-date version of the gospel. The Spirit of Truth was bestowed for the purpose of qualifying believers more effectively to preach the gospel of the kingdom. The Spirit of Truth came to help the believer to witness to the realities of Jesus' teaching and his life as he lived it in the flesh. I think these four quotes really set us up for understanding what the Spirit of Truth is about here. And I said I was only going to have four quotes, but I got one more here that's important. Jesus once commented to his apostles, "You should understand that when this gospel of the kingdom shall have been proclaimed to all the world, the Father will send you another dispensational bestowal." This is the task of the present dispensation. This is what's got to be done. Making sure that the world has a basic understanding of the nature of the kingdom and has begun to kind of put into practice some of the basics, like having a relationship with the Father and being good to each other and, you know, understanding that we're all brothers and sisters in this adventure. That's the basic foundation that has to be in place before the next bestowal, the next epical revelation can happen. Hold on, it gets more interesting. There's some background support here that we should review and be aware of. The thought adjusters continually are assisting in the establishment of the spiritual domain of Michael throughout Nebadon. Now that's a force that's inside every single mortal on the planet. You've got the seraphim The seraphim unify and coordinate the work of the adjuster with the Spirit of truth. And remember that seraphim work in the relationships between personalities. When we have a relationship with another personality, that sets up kind of a morontial field, and that is where the seraphim work, is in the process, actual process of relationships. Profound implications on that for personal ministry. You've got the board of planetary supervisors especially concerned with the supervision of those activities which result from the fact that Michael did his bestowal here. So there's all this background support. Again, the master's personal spirit is focused on actualizing the primary objective of his bestowal, bringing humanity into the kingdom. That's what's going on. The work of all planetary celestial agencies are focused on this task. Don't you suppose that the Urantia Book is somehow related to this? You know, might have a role to play in this? Imagine for a minute that you come back to the planet when it's settled in light and life, and you discover that the whole planet is a vast network of universities dedicated to the study of Michael's bestowal. You know, you and I today have an opportunity to live our lives in such a way that when we come back at that time, we can say, I helped make that happen. Wouldn't that be great? Let's take a few minutes to look at the cultural context here. Culture is important because it's the context in which language is interpreted and understood. Words in the book don't carry meaning by themselves. The meaning is synthesized in the mind of the viewer based on their education, the culture that they live in. The Urantia Book requires a cultural context for understanding. And I understand and I appreciate the fact that the Urantia Book is meant for the entire planet, for everyone. But as is the case with the earlier epical revelations, the Prince's Staff, the Second Garden, those epical revelations are made in a specific cultural context, and it's up to people living in those in that context to then adapt it, translate it into other languages, and adapt it to other cultures. But the initial drop of the epical revelation is into a specific cultural context. It has to be. There's no other way to get it into the planet's thought streams. The cultural stream of epical revelation on our planet runs from Mesopotamia through Hebrew religion to Rome and to the Christian civilization of Western Europe and to North America. The foundational core mythologies and stories of present-day Christian civilization are remnants from the previous epical revelations. In a Jungian sense, the Urantia Book is revitalizing the archetypes of Christian civilization, big time. All of the archetypes, all of the stories are just being re-empowered, revitalized. That's a big deal. The Urantia Book is constructed upon those accumulated stories, the symbols, theology, history, and values of Christian civilization. Just as Jesus built his ministry on the work of Melchizedek, John the Baptist, and Hebrew religion. If President Obama goes to India for a conference or something, there's an advance team that goes out. They go out weeks in advance. They set up communications lines. They deal with security. They set up meetings. They do all the front work for him to show up and do what he needs to do. Imagine the background work that's done when a creator son's going to bestow himself on an evolutionary planet. It happens once in the entire history of the local universe. It's huge. It's huge. So let's take a look here at some things that we might be able to point to and say this is part of the setup, part of the background. What I'd like to do is run a short video here that shows you the spread of Christianity around the world. Now, I'm not unmindful of the fact that there's been a lot of blood and mayhem gone along with that. Colonialism, the ravaging of indigenous people, the destruction of an entire race accompanied the expansion of this story. It's a primitive world, still emerging from barbarism. You know, if human beings fail to follow that flicker of the spirit within them, we're basically animals. And we're a long ways from having gotten out of that state of civilization. The early missionaries crossed the Atlantic on the same ships as the conquistadors. You know, it's just gone hand in hand. But the point is that much of the world now knows the basic story of Michael's bestowal on the planet. And I believe the Urantia Book is here to help enrich the meanings that are in that bestowal and the values to enrich human civilization with those. I want to rewind this to a time when Christianity was at the lowest point in the Holy Roman Empire of the 15th century. It's a time when it appears that the first steps were made in getting ready to bring the Urantia Book to the planet. In the Middle Ages, the midwayers and the angels of the churches, concerned with the direction in which the church had developed, petitioned the Ancients of Days for, quote, a new revelation to be presented to the Christian churches clarifying the true teachings of Jesus, end quote. I have good reason to place this event sometime in the late 15th century. It'd make a whole presentation on its own. It's really interesting to look back at this. We know that the book says Macaventa was on the planet in the last 1,000 years as resident governor general. And I began to think, wow, did Macaventa trigger the Reformation? And, you know, you can get into that. There are a number of things you can look at there. I thought, okay, if he's here every 1,000 years, what happened 1,000 years before the Reformation? And sure enough, 1,000 years before the Reformation, Pope, one of those popes, and Saint Benedict were involved in packing Christianity into monasteries where it could survive the Dark Ages and then emerge at the time of the Renaissance to inform some of the most beautiful art the planet's ever seen. So that period of time around 600 was really critical to secure the story of the bestowal. This little piece here about the angels of the churches and the midwayers petitioning the Ancients of Days, I thought about that and I thought, you know, that doesn't sound right. It's the planet's isolated. They would have had to go through the resident governor general. And we've got a long history with Macaventa. He's been involved with this planet since the time of the life carriers. He was a part of the original life carrier administration. He's the vicegerent planetary prince, so I could easily imagine him pulling the trigger on this. He got this petition from the midwayers, the angels of the church, and churches, and he says, let's go. Well, that's my speculation. It may or may not be true, but whether or not it's true, the Reformation happened. It was the key event of the Middle Ages. The Reformation broke the iron grip of the Roman Church on the Christian story. You know, another thing that happened there, because John Calvin was so interested in making Scripture become an authority, it triggered a wave of literacy as Christianity spread from that period of time out into the world. It was followed by a wave of literacy. Gutenberg's press was to the Reformation as the internet is to the Urantia Book. Interesting, you know. It's a Melchizedek in the Urantia Book who complains, you guys don't know how hard it is to run a revelation when you don't have printing technologies. No. And, you know, there's been a continuous, very dynamic development in Christianity since the time of the Reformation. I want to hit just a few highlights here. It's a fascinating story. It's really fascinating. But a few key things. What's been called the quest for the historical Jesus began in the 18th century. Sometime around 1750, this guy, Herman Reimarus, asked the question, what if Jesus of Nazareth and the Jesus of Western history and Christian thought are not the same? Well, everybody kind of took a second take on that, and they thought, oh my gosh, what if that's the case? And the question has haunted Christianity for 200 years. By the late 19th century, hundreds of versions of the life of Jesus had been published, some scholarly, some fanciful. Some may have been used by the revelators of the Urantia Book. Serious scholarly questions about Jesus have continued to be asked for the past 200 years. It was Albert Schweitzer in 1906 with his Quest of the Historical Jesus. As recently as 1991, there was John Dominic Crossan in his book, The Historical Jesus. It was the life of a Mediterranean Jewish peasant. The most recent and most ambitious quest for the historical Jesus was announced in 2007. It was stimulated by the rapidly growing interest in Jesus among scholars in the late 1990s. The project was to be a 5-year investigation done by a group of 32 scholars. The project fell apart in 2009 because they couldn't stop arguing with each other. But still today, 2,000 years after the facts, scholars around the world and people in the pews and the churches are still asking this question: who was Jesus? What are the implications for my life and for the world in which we live? In the 19th century, there was a whole series of really critical looks at Christianity being taken. The revolutions in the way old texts were analyzed and studied. The scientific views of the Enlightenment began to chip away at Christian beliefs. There was this old thing about God of the gaps. You know, every time science finds something, well, God is in the space between those, you know, and those gaps kept getting smaller and smaller. You know, where's God? You know, we're starting to get a continuous sense of how reality works. By the late 19th century and entering into the 20th century, Scripture was breaking down completely as a basis for authority. And this was the critical issue, and it's kind of the critical issue today. What is the authority? Where is the solid foundation that we can base our lives on, that we can base our beliefs on, from which we can construct a reasonable philosophy of living? You know, Einstein and Heisenberg contributed to it in the sciences. Now time and space are relative. You know, you think something and you change something on the other side of the universe, and now we're in this morass, this morass of relativism. Pentecostalism and charismatic Christianity were really important developments in the 20th century. Pentecostalism, and I use that word, and it embraces a wide range of religious groups, charismatic, Pentecostal. Pentecostalism and fundamentalism were reactions to the loss of authority that was coming down in the 19th century. In fundamentalism, they just said, okay, here's what we're going to believe, regardless of what anybody says. You know, there's hell, there's a virgin birth, there's, you know, this is what we believe. And you just hold fast to that. The charismatics said, yeah, we don't care about that theology. We're going to focus on our relationship with the Spirit. And so you had these two reactions to that same phenomenon of this complete breakdown in authority. Existential and modernist Christianity were critical factors in the 20th century. Don't let me scare you there. It's not as bad as it looks. Existential Christianity sought a return to the religious life and beliefs of the earliest Christians. Read the book of Acts, read Romans. You get a sense of what the early Christian church was like. You know, there's this problem of people, normal people in the churches needing some sustenance. And then you've got academia out here, and you know, very rarefied thought. In the 20th century, you had Alfred North Whitehead and Paul Tillich, brilliant theologians, brilliant work, but it's totally inaccessible to the people in the pews. Just, you know, it's almost as if the whole concept of God just kind of vaporized in the ether out there. You know, a few people could look at it. Modernist Christianity was a complete rejection of anything supernatural and a focus on social action. That's been a big influence. And again, you might ask, why are these things important? Well, they're important because that's the way the thought is going down in the universities and seminaries where the priests and ministers are trained that are going into the churches and then running the services. It conditions their thought. By the 1970s, a new center was forming across Christian denominations, which has continued to grow to the present time and has acquired the label of emerging Christianity. And I'd like to look at emerging Christianity for a moment because it's a very important thing that's happening out there. Emerging Christianity and social media are the two major challenges facing Urantia book readers that want to be involved in disseminating the book. They're important because they both signify a major sea change in the culture out there. Emerging Christianity is not a movement within Christianity the way Methodism was within the Anglican Church. It's a way of describing what's kind of coalescing at the center. And people who are involved describe it as an exploratory conversation. It's very fluid. Christianity is in the greatest period of ferment it's ever been in since the time of the Reformation. Ideal time to drop an epical revelation into that culture. Let me just spend a couple of minutes here and talk about how emerging Christianity has come about and some of the influences on it. 20th century charismatic Christianity brought personal experience with the Spirit to the foreground, participatory worship. They had a great impact on the evangelical churches. Worship sessions changed. They brought in bands. They ran special sessions for younger people. Even the Catholic Church changed their way of doing their services to accommodate this tide that was coming in from the Pentecostals and the Charismatics. By 2006, the number of charismatic Christians in the world exceeded 500 million, making it second only to the Catholic Church in terms of the number of people who are involved in that aspect of Christianity. And about 25% of the people involved in the emerging Christian movement are from that background. So they're bringing in this sense that working with the indwelling Spirit is the key to the spiritual life. AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, was one of the most influential social movements of the past century. The AA Big Book is one of the best sellers of all time, having sold more than 30 million copies since it was published in 1939. It made God personal. It was no longer Yahweh or Allah. It was God as we understand Him. AA dealt a blow to the clergy because it was obvious that the addict was much better at treating an addicted person than a session in the minister's study, you know. That was a big blow to the clergy. It opened the floodgates to spirituality by removing the confines of organized religion. Millions of people have had their lives spiritually transformed by the AA program. It was a huge influence. Buddhism and Eastern spirituality brought new tools and practices to Christianity that were needed to be more subjectively involved with your spirituality. You know, the use of psychoactive drugs brought the nature of consciousness to the foreground of a lot of people's thinking. And there were a lot of other influences. There's a coalescing thing here that's happening as a result of all that's happened over the last century here. Liberal theology tried to reconcile Christianity with secular science and contemporary philosophy. All of these are forces entering into what is becoming known as emerging Christianity. You know, it's just coalescing. You know, it's just kind of happening. There's no real leadership. There are people who are writing, there are blogs, but it's just kind of coalescing there. And once again, the Christian world is being called to order by the simple message of Melchizedek, faith and faith alone. That was the same message. That was Martin Luther's battle cry at the time of the Reformation. Melchizedek's message, faith and faith alone. And here we are again at a time of great ferment, and it's that message of Melchizedek that's pulling people together. So we ask again, why is emerging Christianity so significant? It's the growing response to 19th, 20th century loss of the authority of Scripture and the relativism that has come to characterize contemporary thought. You know, everything's the same now. Everything's the same. All values are all relative. Political concepts are just relative. It's just everything, nothing is firmly attached. And I must say that the Urantia Book authoritatively provides desperately needed authoritative reference. It's desperate, the state that the world is in. Can there be, you know, looking at all these things that have happened here and what's happening in emerging Christianity, can there be any doubt in our minds that the world is being prepared for this revelation? You know, it's taken a lot of time, coming from the time of the Reformation, working through 500 years of history. But here we are at this time of ferment. Earlier I mentioned the rapid increase of academic interest in Jesus in the late 1990s. By the mid-1990s, so many new books about Jesus were being published that Publishers Weekly had to add a new division. Several thousand have been published in the last two decades alone. In 2012, there was at least one new book about Jesus published every day of the year. Go figure that. There is a growing conversation about Jesus taking place in the world today, and I believe the Urantia Book was intended to be a part of that. Jesus has become a cultural icon. People are getting Jesus tattoos. Christian rock has become a major popular music genre. Take a listen to the enthusiasm and energy generated about Jesus by this group, Casting Crowns. I love these guys. We got audio on that? Crank it up, Donnie. Forward to enlist in such a spiritual undertaking. Lift up Jesus to the world. Look at the enthusiasm. We went to one of their concerts in Denver last year. It was amazing. Thousands of people there worshiping and acknowledging Jesus in these concerts. It's absolutely amazing. global Christianity is quivering on the brink of a renaissance of the Master's message of life and hope. Driven in part by the greatest communications and social transformation the planet has ever seen. This is the primary context in which we're asking, well, what do we do about this revelation? How do we get it out there? I sometimes think we're afraid. We've got this huge opportunity out there. Well, they aren't going to like what it says about the atonement. And you know, I've heard so much of that. Oh, the world isn't ready for the Urantia book. So what does the book say needs to be done? The book lists a number of tasks needing to be addressed. Since Phil's syllabus for the meeting here was focused on dissemination, I filtered out those tasks. So I didn't include, you know, get your genetic stuff together and some of the personal things about personal spiritual growth. And I put these items into a short video that I think speaks for itself. I truncated the quotes. If you're a reader of the Urantia book, you're going to recognize these. They're just classic Urantia book quotes. But take a look. This is the core task, and this is what this revelation is here for. So let's take a look at what's actually being done. I'm going to mention a number of projects here, and if I don't mention yours or I miss your website or something, don't feel bad. I was overwhelmed when I started putting this list together. What are readers actually doing out there? We can take a little step back in time. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself here. Here are the things that the major organizations are all doing. UAI, Urantia Foundation, the Fellowship are all involved in these kind of things. I'm not going to go into them in any detail. Reader Services is really the heart of the organizations. You've got Paula, Tamara, the two Joannes providing coordination, service, ministry, sending out books, kind of keeping things organized. These women are inspired ambassadors of the revelation, and I appreciate you so much. I know how hard you work, all of you. You're great. Yeah. Several of the fellowship committees are doing really important dissemination work, particularly international fellowship and outreach. There's just a lot being done there. Those folks, they're dedicated. The people on those committees are some of the hardest working people we have out there for the revelation right now. The Parliament of the World's Religions, which ends today, saw cooperative participation by readers from all the major groups. There are 120 Urantia book readers registered there. What, the total attendance was what, 130? No, there are more than that. I'm just kidding. But there were 6 workshops led by readers of the Urantia book. And talking about organizations, a good office staff is essential for coordinating these kind of things. I'm going to talk about things we can do on a local level. But something like this, you really need not only an office staff, but you should have some kind of an organization with some street creds, you know, and that's important to be able to coordinate, be able to apply, attend at something like this, and also a place where Financial resources can be accumulated to pay for things like this. Book dissemination. Boy, book dissemination is just moving forward on multiple fronts out there. Michelle Klimisch's Pipeline of Light's been in operation for 13 years. And I'd like to use Michelle's Pipeline of Light project as an example of the kind of things that readers are doing that make a huge difference. Her project has put 5,800 books, 5,800 books into the world in 84 countries. Simple project. Michelle put this together. The ladies in the offices, the Joannes and Paula, take care of sending out the books. Readers send in the contributions. No committee meetings, no travel. It's great. Low profile, and things are happening. And I love it. I think that's the way this thing should grow moving forward. Very little administrative overhead. You know, it's still, you've got that office staff, that central office staff, that can coordinate these things, coordinate projects readers and societies are putting together. And as we'll see in a minute, Michelle's, this is just one example of a lot of projects that are happening out there. The societies are doing different things. You've got the New York Society doing their translations. These societies are using their local organizational structure and their 501c3s to make things happen. Now, if you have a 501c3, you can pretty much do anything you want to do. Your society can do any project they want to do. And it doesn't need to be a society project. Individuals within the society, if you get it approved by your governing board, can go ahead and do their project. If Pierre wants to do a 3D model of Salvington that everybody can walk through, Pierre can put this project together. He's got a 501c3 to generate the funding, and he's off and running. So I want to say, don't think in terms of just the society doing things. Individuals and little networks of people within the society can do things as well and take advantage of the society administrative and financial infrastructure. I have a little list here, some historic contributions. You know, the things that have really made a difference in our life with the Urantia Book here have all been done by individuals outside the organization. Look at some of this stuff. These are all things that have made a huge difference in the life of the readership, and they've all been done by individuals with a vision, people who wanted to see something done and went out and did it. Phil Calabrese, 1972, with Bob Hunt, taught a university class. Where are you, Phil? Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was great. But all of these different things, Duane's Parimony, Kristen's Folios, I mean, these were big things. They made a big difference, and they were done by individuals. So I put together a what's actually happening list. This is a list of what is actually happening out there. Dozens of projects that people are doing. And again, if yours isn't on this list, don't feel bad. It was hard to put this together. There's so much going on. Take a look at this. Absolutely amazing. Independent readers have become the vanguard of dissemination and education. Even if you added the UAI and fellowship committees to that list, they'd still be a small part of the total thing that's happening out there. It's huge. You know, that the readers are responding, they're reacting, and they're carrying the ball. And this is just the English readership. There are things like this happening in Latin America and in Brazil. Readers are mobilized. In Bogota, the independent readers, they bought a house and they remodeled a room for a meeting room and then rented out the rest of it to pay the mortgage. What a great idea! When it comes to quality reader community, hard to beat a good study group. And here again, it's the work of individual readers making it happen. Decentralized, low profile, and effective. However, we all have to appreciate the implications of the fact that the number of readers participating in online study groups and social media networks now vastly exceeds the combined membership of all the top-level Urantia organizations. It's in the world of social media where those thousands of study groups are forming. Independent readers now dominate the global front lines of revelation dissemination and community expansion. A growing networked wave of leaders and teachers following the leading of the Spirit of Truth. The implications here for the top-level organizations are profound, very profound. They can no longer think in terms of managing the revelation. Come on. And you can see what's happened with the readership, got this revelation and got mobilized. Imagine what's going to happen when it gets into Christianity. There could be a renaissance of the life and teaching of Jesus in this world that would transform the place in a relatively short time. Okay, here's a quick review of what we looked at. The context in which the book is appearing: celestial planning and supervision within the context of Christian civilization. What the book implies should be done: complete that great commission that Jesus gave us. And what's actually happening now? A dynamic, globally emerging grassroots readership. Now, this is very interesting, because here you have a major religious movement in the process of development that's emerging globally simultaneously from the grassroots. It's not starting in some central location and then spreading out from there. It's happening globally. That's a powerful thing. That's never happened before. This is the first major religious movement in the age of the internet, and it's really being taken advantage of. So let's get back to this main question that we had. What should the organizations be doing to promote the revelation? Let's go back to Mo's presentation. This is a slide from his presentation a couple of weeks ago, and it shows some results from a reader survey of 3,200 serious readers of the book. I was amazed by some of his numbers and just want to point out one. 54% go to church at least annually. That's a lot. This is a vanguard group, in my mind, that needs to be fostered. There's a growing number of Christianity-literate Urantia book readers who are getting into their churches, working into their churches. 65% of these people never even attended a study group. But you got more than half who are going to church. Adapting to social media is one of the biggest challenges confronting the top-level organizations today. Not only are they not even in the game, I don't think they have any clue as to how significant the social media transformation is that's taking place in the world. Haven't got a clue. Social media changes the way in which ideas, especially new ideas, are propagated in the world. And supposedly we're in the business of propagating new ideas, right? You know, social media is also radically restructuring the ways in which people communicate socially. They get together and share ideas. We're supposedly in the business of building social infrastructure, right? These, in my mind, are key areas in which dissemination should be focused if we're going to be effective in the present environment. There are over 500 readers who are members of online Christian groups of Urantia Book readers, sharing information, strategies, stories about what happens in their churches and Sunday school classes. 500, that's about half the membership of the fellowship. And these are readers who are in Christian, working in Christianity. Moe's Truth Book site, truthbook.com, focusing on Jesus, is by far the best and most heavily trafficked website, Urantia site on the internet. It provides a variety of services, community, education, inspiration. These are the gathering places for the people who are going to change the world, these online communities. Let me give you the number one takeaway from this presentation. If you don't remember anything else, take this one away with you. Do we really understand and believe what the Urantia Book says about the Spirit of Truth? Do we really believe it? You know, the book says that there's a quote about a state of mind attaining to faith levels only when it informs the mode of living. You know, and are we making that connection? I can bear witness that when you work on something related to Michael's bestowal, you're going to get a lot of help. A lot of help. This planet is in desperate straits. The barbarians are at the gates of Christian civilization once again. And you've got an epical revelation dropped here in, as kind of an emergency thing. What are we doing about it? You know, are we just going to have a little study group and talk about the absolutes? Or are we going to get out in our communities and do something? You know, we can learn to let that Spirit of Truth be the wind beneath our wings, lifting us to really meaningful service that's of value to people's lives. Okay, so given what we've looked at here, how about some specific suggestions for the top-level organizations and the readers who want to be spreading the book? And I don't want to go into the politics of the organizations. You know, there are people in there working hard trying to make things happen. It's slow. The political processes are so slow that the organizations cannot keep up with the rate of change going on in the world today. I think number one is appreciate that the Christian world is the cultural context which has been prepared to receive the revelation and for whom it was written. I know leadership in both Urantia Foundation and the Fellowship have gone to great extents to keep the book from being associated with Christianity or Jesus. There are millions of people in the world out there today whose lives are dedicated to trying to do the Father's will, trying to do the Master's work, bring the concept of the kingdom to people. A lot of Christians out there doing that on the basis of the New Testament story and whatever connection they've been able to develop with the Spirit of Truth within them. Don't you think it'd be nice to give them a little reinforcement? You know, those are the people for whom the midwayers and the angels of the churches originally petitioned for the revelation that you and I enjoy. We need to be doing what we can to get it to them. Focus on revelation dissemination into existing believer communities rather than allowing competing institutions or competing denominations to develop. I think that's an important one. It's a real important one. You know, in the apocryphal, some of the apocryphal documents and also in one of Bill Sadler's tapes, recordings, he says that the revelators were very clear that they did not want to see a competing Christian denomination develop out of the Urantia movement. Keep it low profile and get the book out there. And if we don't pay attention to what we're doing, we're going to go right down the path of paper 99. Read paper 99, Social Problems of Religion. There's a section in there, I think it's section 6. Section 6, the revelators have a list of some of the problems of formalized religion. Take a look at that list and count how many of them we already have emerging in our communities. You know, if we don't take conscious control of the process, we're part of our culture, you know, and we're going to go right down that same path. Produce conferences as interactive online events. Boy, this one's bugged me for so long. You have an international conference, and people prepare workshops. They do plenaries, and they work really hard. These are some of our best readers preparing these things. And they come and they do a workshop for a handful of people, and that's the end of it. Those things need to be put online. They need to be recorded and saved and put into an archive where more people can benefit from them. You know, it's expensive going to those conferences. Last IC conference for the fellowship had 300 people. And you've got a readership, or at least books out there, approaching 1 million, and you have an international conference and 300 people come. There's a huge number of readers out there that could benefit from having these things put online. Put the mic out there so everybody can hear. Foster ministries rather than building institutions. Yeah. I think that ministering to people is the fundamental thing. Ministering to people in their situations as they are. There's that whole thing of ministers becoming administrators. And we can see that in our organizations. Foster networks instead of creating hierarchies. Boy, this network thing is really great. That's how Michelle did the Pipeline of Light. You build a little network. That's how I did the film, a network of people. You don't build an hierarchical structure with job descriptions and then put the people in and do it. You start actually doing the work. Why not start actually doing the work and then build your administrative structure as you need it and only as much as you need? Networks are great, really great. You know that this person down here does good graphics, and you can call on them to do a poster for you. Or you know, this person over here is the one to bring in when you want to put your thing online. You know, and so you build that network, and you're able to do a lot of things with it. Okay, here's some suggestions for regional and local organizations. Continue fostering study groups as the primary unit of your ranch and community. I really think that's important. Those little study groups are great. People enjoy them, and they're very meaningful. And I think a society can encourage their members to go. And don't just go to one that fits your own level of knowledge of the Urantia book. Go to a simpler one where you can enjoy the people and maybe help somebody out. Educate for service outside of Urantia communities, not just Urantia book content for dedicated readers. Christians do a great job in this area. And I want to point out that Christians have gone through all this stuff that we're going through. They're going through it today. There's a crisis in a lot of churches. They're going through the same thing. What do you do about the millennials? What do you do about social media? You know, go to a Christian bookstore or get online and Google some of this stuff. The answers are out there. They've got resources. There are tons of resources that we can take advantage of and use in our own communities. The other thing is to appreciate that Jesus organized and trained his apostles for revelation work within the context of existing religious culture. We talked a little bit about your 501c3. Help local members actualize their vision and their ideals. And again, it doesn't need to be a big society project. It can be a couple of people have a project they want to do, and the society structure is there to help them get it done. Foster a society culture of financial participation. It costs money to do this stuff. Every one of the fellowships key committees has projects that they are ready to do that they can't do because they don't have enough funding. Get on auto debit in support of your favorite organization. Both UAI and the Fellowship have auto debit options on their websites. Michelle's Pipeline of Light, you can go to the Fellowship site and sign up for auto debit there. You know, give up a couple of lattes a month for the revelation. That could be a t-shirt, wouldn't it? People say they don't have time to participate. I don't know if you know Dave Tucker. I think he was here for Mo's thing. Here's Dave Tucker. The guy produces videos in his car while he's driving to work. I mean, that's great. You've got Larry and Donna Whelan. They're making spiritual vitamins sitting on their sofa watching TV in the evening. So, you know, don't give me this don't have time thing. You can be creative. Those are great projects, by the way. And I hope you'll get good at streaming events like this. I think this is really important to figure out how to do. You know, it's hard, especially in an urban area as wide and as great as Southern California. It's hard for people to get through all that traffic to an event. But you can do this. And I think this is great. I think you're really blazing a trail here with doing this. And, you know, you can build the UBLA brand. Just get it out there. You're showing other societies what can be done. And, you know, if you guys can share the technology or the know-how so other people can make it happen, wouldn't it be great if every society had the ability to do this? You know, they can bring in some of their key people and just share the wealth. You know, I think it would be great. I said I wasn't going to get into politics, but I'm supposed to be making suggestions here, so I do want to, how should I say this? Rather than make a suggestion, let me point out the UAI Constitution, I think, has a great provision. It's the presidents and vice presidents of the national associations who form their governing board. Imagine how much more dynamism could be put into the fellowship if you got rid of that whole TDA general council thing and had an executive council made up of the presidents and vice presidents of the society. Now there'd be some connection from the grassroots up to the top. Right now there's a total disconnect. You know? It's a complete disconnect. The executive committee is a little political fiefdom all of its own, completely not controllable by any group or answerable. That whole structure really needs a radical redoing, and I want to give them credit for at least starting to think about it. There's been some talk of reducing the number of people on the general council, but there's just no communication there from the top to the bottom. And that's part of why I'm encouraging people in the societies and local groups to just keep going. You know, you don't need all that political overhead to get things done. Look at my list. Those are people who got things done out of their own vision without the need for a whole lot of hullabaloo. And so, I have a question for you. Okay? This is a big question. Your answer to this question is going to be discussed by scholars of these early days hundreds of years from now. Will 21st century readers of the Urantia Book introduce the book into existing religious culture, or will they create their own competing sects? You know, we're still at an early time in this movement. It could go either way. In my view, if it gets put into Christian culture, it can spread and grow in a relatively short time. I'm not talking about by next Tuesday, but over a few hundred years. If we get into developing our own competing sect, it could take thousands of years to get it out there. And within another generation or so, the die is going to be cast. All Urantia is waiting. The world has been made ready for a new revelation of the life and teachings of Jesus. The real question is, are we ready to do our part? Christians have been at a funeral for 2,000 years. The Urantia Book says it's time to resurrect the Master from the tomb of traditional theology and present the living Jesus to the church that bears his name. Now there's a direct, this is what you need to do. This is what needs to happen. So in closing, what I did was I went through Jesus' post-resurrection appearances and took out all the verbs and made this little video. Thank you very much.